Ladies and gentlemen, the Majority Leader of the United States Senate, the Honorable Mitch McConnell.
Well, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Capitol. Normally, Speaker Boehner would preside over this ceremony, but sadly, over the weekend, his younger brother, Rick, passed away. So the Speaker's with his family today in Southwest Ohio, and he asked me to send his deepest regrets that he's unable to be here. Today, pursuant to H.R. 1209, we will present a Congressional Gold Medal to the Doolittle Tokyo Raiders. The Gold Medal represents Congress' highest expression of gratitude for distinguished achievements and contributions. It is being presented to the Doolittle Raiders for their outstanding heroism during World War II. After today's ceremony, the medal will make its way to the National Museum of the United States Air Force in Dayton, Ohio, where it will be permanently placed. General John Hudson, the director of the museum, is with us to receive the medal. Thank him for being here. Making this day a reality was the work of many people, especially the families of these heroes, and we thank you all for being here as well. I hope you enjoy today's remarks. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the presentation of the colors by the United States Armed Forces Color Guard, the singing of our national anthem, and the retiring of the colors. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing as the chaplain of the United States Senate, Dr. Barry Black, gives the invocation.
Let us pray. Eternal Lord God, the source of our hopes and dreams, we thank you for the Doolittle Tokyo Raiders, a group of 80 patriots who more than self their country loved. We're grateful for the morale boost their exploits provided a beleaguered nation, infusing America with a spirit of hope when it needed it most. Lord, we ask your special blessings on the two surviving Raiders, retired Lieutenant Colonel Richard Cole and Staff Sergeant David Thatcher. Bless also and comfort the family of a third Doolittle Raider, retired Lieutenant Colonel Robert Height, who recently died. May the inspiration we receive from this Congressional Gold Medal ceremony that celebrates the humble heroism of the Doolittle Tokyo Raiders motivate us to live more laudable lives. We pray in your great name. Amen.
Please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, United States Representative from the 22nd District of Texas, the Honorable Pete Olson.
Good afternoon. I want to start by thanking the Republican and Democrat leaders of both bodies for making this long overdue day happen. A special thanks to Senator Brown for allowing me to be his wingman on this endeavor. In my Navy career, I've landed and taken off an aircraft carrier many times. I want y'all to know what these 80 heroes did on April 18, 1942. That was the first day they dropped off a carrier deck and saw the rush of water come up to greet them. A Japanese patrol boat spotted the Hornet 12 hours before their intended launch. America could not lose the Hornet. So the men were given a choice. Launch, knowing they would go down in enemy territory or scrub the mission forever. All 16 bombers took off and bombed Japanese soil. That soil had never been touched by a foreign power in over 1,000 years. Those 64 bombs did little damage to the Japanese Navy and Army. But the fear that raid put into the Japanese admirals made them want to have a winner-take-all fight with our Navy in the Pacific. We won that fight 2 months later at Midway. After Midway, America was going to win World War II. That would not have happened without the Doolittle Raid. This gold medal ensures we will never forget these heroes who saved our world from tyranny. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, United States Senator from Ohio, the Honorable Sherrod Brown.
Thank you to our legislative leaders, to General Hudson, to John Crown, to Congressman Olson. Thank you. This has been a long time coming. It's been 4 years since Brian Anderson, the Doolittle Tokyo Raiders Association Sergeant-at-Arms, came to my office seeking recognition, recognition the Raiders never sought for themselves. Go back to spring 1942. Americans were still reeling from Pearl Harbor. We had lost battle after battle in the Pacific. To many Americans, Allied forces seemed to be in retreat across the globe. Across the ocean, Japan's arrogance had reached new heights. Japanese generals proclaimed that no one could launch an air attack against Japan. Tojo boasted that in all its 2,000 years of history, Japan had never lost a war. Then that spring, 80 Americans embarked on a mission many thought impossible. The airmen knew the dangers. They knew many of them would not come home. But the Raiders showed America and showed the world that yes, Japan could be invaded. They showed that yes, the US and Allied forces could win the war. After the war, when they returned, when the airmen returned, they talked little of their service. They went back to their daily lives in Ohio and Texas and Kentucky and Illinois and Louisiana and California. They blended into American life of the 1940s. When asked about the raid by the New York Times, Lieutenant Colonel Saylor said, "It was just a mission we did in the war. We did what we had to do." Like my dad, the Doolittle Raiders came from a generation that spoke proudly of service to our country, but rarely drew attention to their own courage. They sought no recognition, but oh, how they earned it. That's why I'm so honored to play a role in the awarding of this medal today. To the Raiders still living, Lieutenant Colonel Dick Cole, Staff Sergeant Dave Thatcher, whose son, Jeff Thatcher, is here with us today. Also to the 78 no longer with us, thank you for what you did for this country. Because of you, we live in a free and a grateful nation. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the United States Army Band. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, the Majority Whip of the United States House of Representatives, the Honorable Steve Scalise.
Good afternoon. I'm proud to be here with you today, and especially as someone who represents part of the city of New Orleans, where we host the National World War II Museum, where we pay tribute to those brave men and women of the greatest generation that defended our freedoms during World War II. Almost 73 years ago today, 80 brave airmen stepped forward and volunteered for a mission that they knew very well may be their last. These 80 men, the Doolittle Tokyo Raiders, believed that our freedoms, liberties, and the defense of our nation, our American way of life, in fact, were worth flying into the unknown and risking their lives for. They believed that their selfless participation in this mission was simply, as they put it, doing their job. After Japan's attack on Pearl Harbor, the American war effort was demoralized and wounded. Lieutenant Colonel James Doolittle and his men's heroic raid over Tokyo helped turn the tide back in our favor and telegraphed a message to the rest of the world that America will not back down. And in fact, America will fight and will win. Today, as members of the House and Senate leadership, but more importantly as Americans, it is our honor and privilege to present this Congressional Gold Medal to the Doolittle Tokyo Raiders in recognition of their bravery, their valor, sacrifice, and great service to our nation. God bless America.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Democratic leader of the United States House of Representatives, the Honorable Nancy Pelosi.
Good afternoon. Senator Brown, Representative Olson, thank you for giving us this opportunity today. It's an honor to be here with all of you. Lieutenant General John Hudson, thank you for your leadership. Just looking at the program and all of these names listed here, what a heavy list of honor and valor and courage. How wonderful that we are honoring them today. It's fitting that we come together today in Emancipation Hall, because today marks the 150th anniversary of the death of President Abraham Lincoln, 7:22 a.m. this morning. As we gather to pay tribute of the impossible, incredible bravery of the Doolittle Raiders, President Lincoln's words on the battlefield of Gettysburg ring true as ever. The world will no longer remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did. What they did. As a representative of San Francisco, I take special pride because it was less than 4 months after Pearl Harbor on April 2, 1942, that the USS Hornet steamed under the Golden Gate Bridge and out of San Francisco Bay. On her deck, 16 B-25 medium bombers, planes never intended to take off from an aircraft carrier, planes that could never land back on the Hornet once launched. Their crews had volunteered when they knew nothing more than the mission's importance would be matched only by its perils. Their training and preparation for an unprecedented action had been compressed into a scant few months. Still, at every chance to back out, these 80 men kept stepping forward to see the raid through. And so, days later, hundreds of miles short of the planned launch point, 80 men and 16 planes vaulted into the sky, racing toward their targets in the enemy homeland, placing their hopes in a successful crash landing on the Chinese coast. Reeling from the surprise attack on Pearl Harbor, with the forces of democracy being driven back in every theater, our nation needed a reason to believe. The Doolittle Raid was just that. In a letter to Captain Ted Lawson after the war, the commanding officer of the USS Hornet during the mission wrote, "To Americans grimly facing reverses on every front, it brought an electric shock of hope." As General Jimmy Doolittle himself wrote years later, our country, faced with the greatest adversity we had ever experienced, had fought back. Some were killed or executed, some were grievously wounded, some faced harrowing years of captivity. But the Doolittle Raiders had pierced the invulnerability of the Axis war machines. They had given a rattled America a reason to believe victory was within reach. For all of those men who made it through the raid in one piece, the war was only just the beginning. With many more dangerous missions ahead, more raiders would give their lives before the final victory was won. "Toujours au danger," cried their motto, and ever into danger it was. I just want to say something to the families of our members of the Air Force. Now it's the Air Force. As I travel in Europe and in North Africa, my colleagues can attest to this, we always visit the American cemeteries there. And what is always remarkable to me is as we look across at all the tombstones and how proud and how brave they were and how proud we are of everyone, we have to usually go to the wall to see the names of those who were in the Air Force, because that's the way it is. No remains. And I know that that is another gift that the families give us, not just the courage of their family members, but to have not ever to be able to come home, but nonetheless to be recognized forevermore on those walls. And it's not any surprise that when we go to those walls, we are escorted usually by the Air Force. Everyone is in tears because of the freedom that people have given us with their lives, with their entire being. So I thank you, families of the Air Force, for that history, those gifts to our country. Now, after the raid, as before, these men believed they had a job to do, and they meant to see it through, no matter how long or how hard it would be. 7 decades later, we are still awed by the sheer audacity of the Doolittle Raid and the incredible men whose grit and bravery made it possible. We're honored by their courage, inspired by their sacrifice, humbled by their humility and their effectiveness and their strength. Though time has thinned their ranks, it will never dim the daring of their deeds. For their service, for their valor, for their awakening of the indomitable spirit of our nation in the darkest hour of our need, we are proud to honor the Doolittle Raiders with the Congressional Gold Medal with thanks and respect. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Assistant Democratic Leader of the United States Senate, the Honorable Dick Durbin.
Good afternoon. Think back for a moment. Where were you? Where were you on September 11th, 2001? We all have that memory, don't we? It's something you'll never forget as long as you live. 60 years before, there was another day just like that in American history, December the 7th, 1941, a message which electrified America. We'd been attacked at Pearl Harbor. Brave men and women had died. And a war was declared just hours after in the hall of the U.S. House of Representatives when President Franklin Delano Roosevelt came and described that day that would live in infamy. And then it was his job as Commander-in-Chief to rally the American people and our forces to win that war. He summoned Winston Churchill to come across the ocean and meet with him in the White House. 2 weeks after Pearl Harbor, Franklin Roosevelt, the Commander-in-Chief, sent the order to the military, attack Japan. He knew that he had to make the point that they were not invulnerable, and he had to prove to the American people that we had the will to stand up and fight back against the odds. Lucky for him, and lucky for America, 80 brave Americans stepped forward to volunteer for this mission. Some might have described it as a suicide mission. We're going to fly bombers off a carrier. We're not going to have fighter escorts. We're going to have to give up our armament on these bombers because of these 400 or 500 pound bombs that we have to transport such a great distance. We're going to find ourselves out in the ocean, and as Congressman Olson said earlier, spotted by the Japanese, and we have to leave earlier now, a greater distance, and we're going to have to ditch these planes after it's over, perhaps in China, perhaps in Russia, perhaps in the ocean. These 80 men stepped forward and said, "We'll do it." Nelson Mandela was asked about courage. He said, "Courage is not the absence of fear, but the triumph over it." These 80 men, the Doolittle Raiders, triumphed over fear. They went out on that mission, and amazingly, 69 of them returned. I'd like to recognize Major Griffith Paul Williams, a raider from my home state of Illinois. During the Doolittle raid, Major Williams co-piloted the 15th B-25 bomber. It was a flight that almost didn't happen. One of the engines on the plane wasn't working. They couldn't get it running. And they told him that if they couldn't get that plane up and running in time, they're going to have to push it overboard when the other bombers launched. That's when Lieutenant Colonel Edward Saylor, the crew's engineer, said, "We're in this mission to stay." Remarkably, he took the engine off the aircraft and rebuilt it and put it back on the plane. And when they asked him, "Do you think it's going to work?" he said a line we can all relate to. "Well, there aren't any parts left over." The engine worked. The mission was successful. Unfortunately, Edward Saylor couldn't be here today. He passed away just a few months ago. But before he died, they asked him how it felt to be a hero. And he said, "There's no way you can call yourself a hero. That's for someone else to say." Well, today, the Congress of the United States of America is calling Edward Saylor and the other 79 other Doolittle Raiders just that, heroes. And on behalf of freedom-loving people in the United States and everywhere, we say thank you for your service and a job well done.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Majority Leader of the United States Senate, the Honorable Mitch McConnell.
For decades, a group of survivors gathered annually to remember a mission that never should have succeeded. From silver chalices before them, the balmy aroma of strong elixir. In chairs beside them, reminders of what they had worked together to accomplish. In empty spaces near them, reminders of what they had since lost. And then at the end of each ceremony, a roll call. Heroes saluted, fallen comrades remembered. And with swills of brandy, a toast from the Doolittle Raiders, a toast to a fateful mission across the Pacific that helped change the course of war, and with it, history. The success of their raid, launched April 18, 1942, did indeed seem improbable. But Jimmy Doolittle's volunteers flew anyway. There were five extra crews, and everyone wanted to go. One raider remembered. One individual offered $1,000 to anybody willing to give up his seat, but there were no takers. 80 raiders took off that morning, and just over a year ago at the National Museum of the U.S. Air Force, three surviving raiders met to commemorate it. The raiders may have been few that day, but they weren't alone. As their motorcade rolled forward, grateful crowds came into view. As their eyes turned upward, B-25s soared overhead. The gratitude of an entire nation there for each of them to see. So a few weeks later, when the Raiders met to clink goblets one last time, it would have been easy to think of so many empty cups with sorrow. But I hope they remembered all that had been gained instead. Morale for a nation, achieved through their bravery, freedom for millions, secured with victories of free people, and bonds of enduring friendship, strong as the brandy used to toast it. And there's something else, too. The gratitude of a nation that hasn't forgotten, a nation that won't forget. Lieutenant Colonel Dick Cole and Staff Sergeant David Thatcher saw it that day outside the Air Force Museum. And this Saturday, on the 73rd anniversary of the raid, these survivors will see another reminder when they present the medal we bestow today to the very same museum. Today, we hope these veterans and the family of every Raider veteran will see it here, too. So let me invite General Hudson to join us on the stage. Come on up, General. It is now our high privilege on behalf of the American people to present the Congressional Gold Medal, the highest civilian honor Congress can bestow in honor of the Doolittle Tokyo Raiders.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Director of the National Museum of the United States Air Force, Lieutenant General John Hudson, United States Air Force, retired.
Leader McConnell, Assistant Democratic Leader Durbin, Leader Pelosi, House Majority Whip Scalise, Senator Brown, and Representative Olson, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for the great honor today of accepting the Congressional Gold Medal on behalf of our Doolittle Raiders and having the chance to say a few words on their behalf. The 80 Doolittle Raiders, led by then Lieutenant Colonel Jimmy Doolittle, were 100% volunteers. Almost none of them knew the details of the mission until the carrier task force had departed the continental United States. The advanced ages of the two surviving Raiders preclude their attendance here today. If here, though, the Raiders would tell you that they just wanted to help out with our nation's war effort, that they volunteered for what was described as a difficult and dangerous mission. The Raiders would tell you that they were in our nation's Army, within our Army Air Forces, and that was their Army Air Forces teammates, the crew chiefs, maintainers, weaponeers, fuel specialists, and more, who helped them train and prepare the airplanes for the mission. Their professionalism, innovation, and ingenuity continues today in our nation's Air Force, just as it did in our Army Air Forces. The Raiders would also tell you that our nation's Navy transported the Raiders and their aircraft to the launch point with a task force which included the USS Hornet, the carrier which held the 16 B-25 bombers, that it was Navy Captain Francis Lowe who came up with the original concept for the mission, that it was their Navy teammates who also helped them train and prepare for the mission. The Raiders would also tell you that North American Aviation, part of our nation's arsenal of democracy, designed and built the B-25 Mitchell bomber, a robust platform, as it turns out, that was capable of taking off from an aircraft carrier and delivering the blow which helped turn the strategic tide of World War II. The Doolittle Raiders serve as a model of excellence to all current-day United States Air Force airmen. The joint team, which accomplished that daring mission, is an inspiration for all of today's military and indeed to America, all of America. The Raiders, with the help and support of our Army, Navy, and American industry, achieved the unimaginable. In accordance with public law and consistent with the wishes of the Doolittle Raiders, our nation's National Museum of the United States Air Force, located at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Dayton, Ohio, will place their Congressional Gold Medal on permanent display within the Doolittle Raider exhibit in our World War II gallery. The medal will be next to the display case containing the AV silver goblets, one for each Raider, donated by the city of Tucson to the Raiders in 1959. The medal will go on display this weekend. To begin its twofold mission of helping to inform and educate the American public about the Doolittle Raid and our military history and heritage. And secondly, to inspire and motivate current and future generations of American youth toward greatness, as exemplified by the Raiders and their military teammates. At our National Museum of the United States Air Force, we will keep this story alive and prominent. More than 1 million visitors annually will see the medal and read about it in person, and another more than 4 million visitors will see high-definition photography of the medal and read about its story online. In just a minute, you will hear a pre-recorded video statement from Lieutenant Colonel retired Dick Cole, the senior of the two surviving Doolittle Raiders. Dick Cole was then Lieutenant Colonel Jimmy Doolittle's co-pilot on that mission, which took place 73 years ago this coming Saturday, 18 April. Jimmy Doolittle, Dick Cole, and their other three crew members were in the first aircraft off the flight deck of the USS Hornet. They had the shortest amount of takeoff space available. They did it and paved the path forward for the next 15 airplanes. Lieutenant Colonel Dick Cole turns 100 years young this September. He and then Sergeant David Thatcher, now 93, are the two surviving Doolittle Raiders of the 80 who flew the mission on 18 April 1942. You can be assured that the Doolittle Raiders, those two who still survive, and all the others who have passed on, are extremely grateful for this most prestigious honor, the Congressional Gold Medal, bestowed on the Doolittle Raiders by our United States Congress. Thank you very much, and now let's play the video.
My name is Lieutenant Richard E. Cole, and along with Sergeant David M. Thatcher, we are today the only surviving Doolittle Tokyo Raiders. We want to thank Congress for enacting and presenting the Congressional Gold Medal to the Tokyo Raiders this day or April the 15th, 2015. On behalf of our 78 fallen Raiders, we are proudly served with on the famous raid. We are honored to accept this prestigious and most appreciated award. We have asked the National Museum of the United States Air Force to display our Congressional Gold Medal in the Doolittle exhibit as part of our history, along with 80 silver goblets for all visitors to enjoy.
Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, the United States Army Band and Chorus. Ladies and gentlemen, the chaplain of the United States House of Representatives, the Reverend Patrick Conroy.
Let us pray. God of power, God of justice, it is because of the weakness and failures of our human nature that the terror of war so often plagues the human family. And yet, it is during wartime that the greatness of human spirit is so often demonstrated. In 1942, our nation was reeling from a preemptive strike by Japan upon the Pacific Fleet. Japan, no doubt, feared what the United States might use that fleet for. It was a shocking blow. The 80 men who volunteered for a virtual suicide mission did not strike a similar blow upon Japan. Little damage was done to the military force of that nation. The success of their mission, rather, was in the tremendous message of hope that we Americans could respond to the dangers of powerful enemies despite impossible odds. Today, only two raiders remain, Lieutenant Colonel Dick Cole and Staff Sergeant David Thatcher. May the breath of God uphold their noble and heroic story. May it carry to other generations and even to other nations a message to inspire citizens everywhere to believe and act upon the truth that there is no greater aspiration than to be willing to lay down one's life to save others. May those who made the ultimate sacrifice that day and thereafter rest in peace, along with those companions who have joined them in eternity in the years since. Bless all women and men in military service, their families, and all those who put themselves in harm's way for the safety of others. God bless America, and grant us peace, both in the present and with you forever. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, please remain at your seats for the departure of the official party.